Welcome to Speech Talk Live. This is episode number 21. My name is Jay Oza, and today I have Julie Finkelstein joining us, and she's a mentor for this course called Introduction to Public Speaking, and I'm also a mentor. I live in Hazlitt, New Jersey, which is about 50 miles from New York City. And again, the purpose of this Speech Talk Live is basically four things: to learn about public speaking by discussing topics, reviewing speeches, and looking at some expert speakers and see what we can learn from them. Second is we also teach. If there are a lot of people out there who are scared of public speaking, and if there is anything that we can learn and pass on to them, that's what we try to do on this show. And, you know, I don't believe there are any experts. Public speaking is a continuous thing, because every speech you give is going to be different. The audience is different. The venue is different. And you have to adjust. And this is an opportunity to practice that. The third thing is we also share. We do a lot of speeches, record speeches, and then we share them. And it's a good way to do a self-evaluation, but also get feedback from others, so you can get an idea what others think, and you can even ask questions on what you want others to focus on, so that you're improving. And lastly, this is a support group. We tend to support each other, because public speaking, if you are really giving speeches, the stakes are going to be high out there. And here's a place where you can personally raise the stakes, but not feel any consequences in case it doesn't go well. So again, this is the place to be if you want to become a good speaker, a confident speaker, and somebody who wants to get the maximum out of different situations you find yourself in when you're speaking. Today's agenda is, the way we start out is we do a 3-minute speech segment where you can pick any topic you want and talk for 3 minutes, because this is the maximum amount of time that somebody's going to give you when you are talking to somebody at a party, at a conference, or any social situation. And this is your way to really come up with, convey your message or some insight or whatever story that you want to tell, where the objective at the end is that the other person would want to know more. So that's where you kind of get into a conversation. I kind of call it conversation tango, you know. that you're a leader and a follower. So think of it as a tango, but here you're doing it with conversation. So that's the first segment today we're going to focus on is logic. This is something that's obvious but not really covered, and I want to really focus on the importance of logic and why logic is so important in a speech. Because a lot of times you talk about, like, oh, he was such a great speaker, oh, he gave us great stories, oh, he was so funny. But if you don't have good logic, the speech is not going to endure. So we're going to have a discussion, myself and Julie. And then the second segment is a speech that Julie had sent me. It's Elizabeth Gilbert, this famous author who's famous for that book, Eat, Pray, and Love, I think. And she's a great writer, but here she gives a kind of a compact speech, about 7 minutes, about creating and or creativity. And we're going to have review that speech and see how she conveys that message. And the last segment is this famous speech given by Randy Pausch, who was a professor at Carnegie Mellon. And the speech is called A Last Lecture. And this is the last lecture speech he gave before he dies from pancreatic cancer. And I think there's a lot to learn from this speech. First of all, it is his last speech, and how he handles himself and delivers the speech and the message that he's trying to convey. It makes you think, like, what kind of last speech would you give? So we'll have a discussion around that. So that's basically the show. At this point, I will let Julie do a quick intro. Hey, wait a second. We got a Latesh is here. Latesh, we thought you'll never join us. I'm so excited.
Same here.
I'm staring at the camera, and all of a sudden, I see Latesh. Oh, sorry about the little outburst there. we get happy. Not that I don't mind Julie here, but we do sometimes. We do somebody else.
No problem, Derek. Good, right. To really touch base after long.
Okay, yeah, great you can join us. So at this point, I will let Julie and Latesh do a quick introduction, and then we'll do our 3-minute speeches. Okay, Julie, take over.
Thanks, Jay. Good morning, Latash. So good to see everybody, whoever's there. So my name is Julie, and one of the things I do is I run a Saturday morning, Eastern Time, 9 o'clock, a book called Uncover Your Own Success. It came out of the public speaking idea that some people have trouble speaking and even making up words, so we read and then we discuss, so kind of like a warm-up. And tomorrow's topic is going to be Stephen Covey's famous Circles of Concern and the Circles of Influence. And we just have a major milestone. We finished our first book, which is Search Inside Yourself. And now the next book we'll be moving to is a rather esoteric book. But it was suggested by a member. So we're going to read I Am a Strange Loop, which is actually a follow-up of by the guy who wrote the book about Goethe. What's it? The whole thing about how the self looking into the self. So it'll be interesting. Thank you.
Okay, I'll introduce myself. Thanks, Julie. Hi, Jay. So my name is Lakesh Balakrishna, and I'm based out from India. The southern part of India is a place called Kochi. I work in the software industry as a project manager. And I have got plenty of opportunities inside this field to travel and explore the world. My hobbies are like running fitness-related activities. I participate in marathons too, and reading and be updated. I take this opportunity to join this forum along with Jay, Julie, and today we don't have Soumin with us, but normally he also joins us. So otherwise, it's a really constructive area wherein we can improvise on our public talking skills, and it's really good to connect like this every weekend at the end of the week when you are having a hectic week schedule, and then at the end you can actually unwind, discussing a lot about various topics, and it's really great to be here talking to the team and getting constructive feedback and scope for improvements. It's a gradual process, but it is really fantastic to be part of this particular forum. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Latesh. So let me just emphasize what Latesh just said, that most of us, I don't know about others, but myself, I don't get a chance to discuss the topics that we pick for the show. Other people are pretty busy, and it's very difficult to devote like even 15 seconds and have this type of discussion. So these are the kind of discussions that we need to have, these type of conversations. A lot of the conversations we have tend to be mostly small talk, or as I call it, mid-talk, which are current events or work-related. We don't really get to talk about topics that require some deep thinking and where you have to give your opinions on it. So this is the only opportunity I get in a week. Otherwise, it's rare, unless I talk to one of my friends from North Carolina, we get to talk about politics. So if you want to become a good speaker, public speaker, you have to first get comfortable talking about topics that are going to be a little bit involved. And here's an opportunity to do it. So this is something that I just wanted to emphasize what just Latesh said, that it's a time from that. And it's, again, no stress. There's no, like, if you don't do well, nobody's going to get fired or kicked off the show, at least not yet. We haven't kicked off anybody yet, but you never know. That can happen. But so at this point, we're going to move to the three-minute speeches. And, again, this is something we created, an opportunity where you get 3 minutes to practice something that you are likely to bring up with somebody. And this is the way to do it, right? Practice 3 minutes. That's enough time, right? Get somebody really interested in what you have to say. So I'll go first, unless somebody else wants to go first, because I always go first. If you're not unmuting, I'll go first. Okay, nobody's unmuting, so I'll go first. So I'm going to talk about the importance of speaking. And, if you're watching this, you agree that speaking is very important. But let me just give you some some observation that I just recently made. And part of it is from the show, and part of it is also watching the television, especially the debates. If you are a really good speaker, you can turn things around so quickly. And this is something that I have seen, and also doing research. And let me just give you three quick examples. One is something that I mentioned in the last show was the Kennedy-Nixon debate. Before going into the debate, Nixon was the favorite. After the debate, Kennedy became the favorite. That was a major shift from one debate, the first debate, where people thought that Nixon was a sitting vice president, he was going to win. Debate changed everything. Okay, so that's one example that everybody knows about. The perception, that's how people perceived it after the debate, that suddenly now that Kennedy was the favorite. So let me give you a second example. And this one is current. This is to do with the current, you know, we're having an election. In America, the election lasts for like 2 years. Well, actually, it lasts for 4 years. As soon as somebody gets elected, the next election cycle starts the next day. So anyway, there was a debate, the Republican debate, and there was this candidate named Carly Fiorina. Many of you may have heard of her. She used to be the CEO of Hewlett-Packard, and we're not going to go into the history. She was actually fired from that job, but evidently she's a great debater. In the first debate, she was, they called it the undercard, and she did extremely well, and she elevated herself to appear in the next debate with the main card, as they call it, with others. And she did well, too, in the second debate. So here again, we took a person who was so low in the polls, and from her debate performance, she elevated herself. So in that one debate, she went from somebody that very few people knew about her to suddenly somebody now people were like saying, hey, she could be a potential potential candidate to be a real, has a serious shot to be a president. So again, how a debate can change a perception quickly. And just the most recent one was the debate, the Democratic debate between all the Democratic candidates, but especially, you know, Hillary Clinton and Bernie Sanders. Hillary Clinton is considered favorite, but her debate performance was so good that suddenly now people are dropping out. Today, another candidate dropped out, and now there are only three left, and most people basically think it's already done. This race is already over. She's going to win. And that all changed with that debate performance. So again, this is our observation. You know, politics in a democracy is very transparent, and here you get a quick idea on how speaking can make a difference. And the same thing can happen to you, whether you're having a conversation with somebody, whether you're at work. Do not minimize the importance of changing things with the power of, you know, speaking. Okay. Julie, you want to go next?
Yeah, thanks, Jay. So I'm going to talk a little bit about using logic and then breaking logic in terms of how to use it for in a successful speech and also how you can approach life. So basically, logic is that you have a set of premises. So let's say we can just say honesty is good. It leads to being trustworthy. Okay, so let's say we want to make a speech on that. So the logic says honesty is good, and therefore you want to be honest. If you're dishonest, your life will have more problems. And then also you can look for honest people, and therefore your life is will be happier, and you have reliable friends. That's a pretty simple logic. And so in this case, I've shared with you the prima facie, the underlying assumption. When you look at, so how does this help you in making a speech or in listening to other people's speeches? In making a speech, you want to make your logics very clear, and then you want to follow through with the facts and the evidence and thinking that makes that logic true. So here I can give an example. yesterday, a friend of mine called me up, and she was supposed to meet me somewhere. And when I texted her, she said, oh, I left you two messages, but the phone didn't connect. So she said, you'll see that you have two contacts on your phone from me. So, of course, that's a very interesting thing, because we've been chatting on the chat box, and all of a sudden she wants to, she's calling me. So I checked my phone log, and there was no contact. So based on the argument, I could very easily share with you that because she was not honest, at least I think that she's not honest, that I really don't want her to be my friend. Okay, I'm simplifying the situation. So that's the use of logic. And because I've used these examples and I've laid out my premise, my speech is, at this point, I hope fairly understandable. If it isn't, please shake your head or something. And you can use this idea of logic. What are the underlying prima facie? What are they trying to say? In situations, also when you're listening to your speech or receiving a message. So if you look at the commercials, there's always the idea that you are lonely, you're unhappy, you have a problem. This product is great. If you buy it, you will be happy. Okay, so now that you understand the prima facie, you can look through the message and say if that's true or not. So that's a use of logic. I want to go a little bit beyond that, because to carry that example further, if I just use my logic, I like honest people, and I don't want to have friends who are dishonest, I would have cut her out of my life. But I looked at my prima facie and said, is that always true? And then, no, it's not always true, because sometime in life, we all make little lies, especially when life is difficult. So my prima facie change, my underlying change, is there an opportunity for compassion and understanding? So I don't know what happened, and it actually may be a technical error, but challenging my own prima facie, I'm opening up my heart a little bit more. And so my relationship is different, and I'm using this whole incident as an example that sometimes you want to know what your logic is, but you also want to challenge it. And you want to do that in your speeches to make a deeper, larger speech. You definitely want to challenge it with the examples that you give. So I gave you a personal example. I'll give you a larger example. So in the 70s, there's this sociologist, and he wrote the book called The Structure of Scientific Revolution, Kuhn, K-U-H-N. And he actually says the paradigm drives the hypothesis and therefore the knowledge that's gleaned. And so again, there is a period where the underlying the hypothesis change because the underlying scientific assumptions change. And so life goes on. We evolve when we challenge our prima facie. So I invite you to use logic, but also to break logic to make your life both more effective, but also a chance for new findings. That's my speech today. Thank you.
Excellent, Julie. Yeah, you know, we're going to be having a discussion on logic later, so maybe you can add more later on.
I'm sorry. I thought this was the logic speech.
Okay. That's okay.
We can revisit that again.
You can give more examples. Okay.
Okay. I was wondering why you didn't do a logic speech.
It's coming. Latesh, go ahead.
Okay. So I'm going to give a talk on uncertainty. The topic today actually influenced me to think about this. I just thought about speaking on this subject just about 10 minutes back. So I would just just introduce these concepts. Like, uncertainty is something that we experience every day, every moment of our life. We have this by definition of uncertainty is like a situation in which we are fearing something which is not known, something that is not in our control. So there is this fear of uncertainty, fear of failure, fear of an outcome out of a decision that we are going to make. So from that angle, why is that this kind of fear sits inside, that fear of the uncertainty? So the main reason is that most of us, in fact, goes by this a plan for our life, right? So we have set expectations, we have set milestones. We think that at every phase, say, when I reach 25, I should be here, I should be earning so and so, my personal status should be so and so. When I reach 40, I should be here, I should be having so and so, this should be my assets, this should be my personal life, how it should be. I reached 50, I have defined our goals, we have set targets. Now, so we go by a specific schedule. At least most of us tend to go by that. But as such, life is not actually a project plan, or it's not like something that you can define and go by the rules. There are so many elements that plays into this facets of life. So what we decide today in the present state, probably we think so much like how it is going to affect my future state. If I decide on a particular decision, if I make a specific choice now, probably how does it impact my expectations? So if there is an expectation mismatch, how it is that I'm going to play it along and make sure that I reach that particular target? So there are so many things going inside the mind. The fear that if we do something now, if we choose something now, if we if we accept something now, how is it going to impact us? How is it going to impact our expectations, our goals, our milestones, our plans? And then there is this fear of, and we feel anxious, we feel a kind of hysterical about these decisions that we are going to make. So this kind of fear, it happens every aspect, whether it is in our personal decisions, in our professional decisions. There are things that is something that may not be in our control, but we are like trying to play along, we are trying to make a decision at some point, which sets some kind of mismatch, and which causes this kind of a situation wherein we feel uncertain. So how do we actually solve this? My idea of solving this is to embrace it, that is, embracing uncertainty. Now, how do we do it? Just start with a clean state, and work towards it. Just start, just put out all your expectations out from the, and just put a clean slate and how you can shift your perspectives. So accept what things are not in the control and see how we can actually work on them. We need to introspect ourselves, know ourselves. Probably we can bridge the personal and professional angle, bring some spirituality, meditate, think and introspect inside ourselves, how we can accept the changes and be more flexible. Maybe we can shift our focus to something that would actually trigger our emotions in a positive way. And probably we can be more comfortable in a discomfortable situation as well. So that's how we can actually work towards embracing this uncertainty, embracing this unknown decisions that we are going to make now, which is going to impact our future. So that's about it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, that was good. Yeah, you may want to add more when we review that Elizabeth Gilbert speech, because I think some of the things you just said might be related to how she handles it. And she, I don't know if she used the word uncertainty, but I think it's her whole concept of on how she goes back home. That's what she calls it, right? Going back home. It's loosely tied to that. I'm not sure it's exactly, but you can, when we talk about that, you can add in and see if there was anything there she's talking about that has to do with uncertainty. I think there is, but we'll see. Okay, at this point, I'm going to take a brief pause and we'll move to our first segment on logic. Okay, welcome to Speech Talk Live, episode number 21. My name is Jay Oza, and we're going to have a discussion on a topic of logic, especially the importance of logic. The reason I decided to have a discussion on it, and I wanted to get Julie and Letitia's input and viewpoint on this, is that I think today we're becoming so visual, and also our attention span is so limited, that one part that people do not tend to focus on is logic. Logic is sort of something that's there, but it's not there, right? It's, you kind of get taken in by person's presence. I mean, today, Julie and I had a discussion last week. The modern speech is not today just based on the three attributes that Aristotle brought up a long time ago, ethos, bathos, and logos. There's a lot of other parts to it, such as charisma, such as being concise. There are so many other aspects to it. Also, like targeting your audience, micro-targeting now, especially now that we know, we tend to know so much about the audience through social media. But the one part that is has to be most important, I think, is logic. Because if a speech is going to endure, it's going to endure because of its logic. And I tend to, this is my view, if a speech doesn't have good logic, let's say it's got terrible logic, then there are only three things that you can glean from that as a, from that speaker. Either that speaker is an entertainer, either that speaker is a total fool, or the speaker is completely evil. Okay, those are only three things when their logic isn't good. And if a logic is good, then its logic is kind of cold, right? Because you don't go into the logic part. Nobody analyzes a speech like it's some, hey, was that a deduction? Was that an induction? It's sort of like a feel. You know when something is logical, it makes sense. You don't have to be a logician, you know, or one of these, put a truth table and try to figure it out. That's looking at understanding the logic at its essence. But a simple logic is like a feel type of thing. Either you feel it's real or it's not real. You don't have to think too hard. So the burden is really on the speaker to help the listeners with the logic. And the logic has to be such that you have to respect the intelligence of your speaker. This is not something where, hey, I'm going to not provide this information because I want to win this argument. A good logic has to sustain after the speech is over. And the simpler it is, the better it is for the audience. And if the audience feels smarter, and you have given them, like, here's, you can have a position. There's nothing wrong with having a position. Somebody may agree or disagree. But the one thing you always want to keep in mind is, this is my opinion on this, you want to have a position. You don't want to give a speech just so that you're liked. You're giving a speech because you want to persuade. And even if it means that you're persuading one person, your speech was successful. If everybody likes you, but nobody does anything, then what have you really accomplished? You're just liked. But that's not the purpose of giving a speech, just to be liked. Then you might as well become an entertainer. A speech is about purpose. There has to be a purpose for giving a speech. And when you're working on a speech, the first thing you have to get right immediately is your logic sound? Can people poke holes in that logic? If they can poke holes, then you got to fix it, because otherwise that speech is not going to endure. People are not going to spread the message, or they're not going to take action. And a lot of times, sometimes the speech, I can't figure out what the real logic is. Logic has to be so simple. And after, you know, you two have a chance, I'll give you some examples of how great speeches, if you notice, have great logic. The logic is so simple that it's very hard to argue against. We looked at a speech last week when Reagan gave at the Point to Hook. There was a lot of logic in that speech about the future of Europe, the future of Western countries when they had to when there was a threat from Soviet Union. A logic endures. If you're entertaining, after a while you'll forget it, you'll laugh at it, but it's not going to endure. And if you go through history, you'll find that great speeches are great not because the way they're delivered or all sorts of voice and all that. That's fine for today's age, but at the end of it, the key part of a speech, great speeches or even good speeches, it's a real good logic. Julia, you want to add more to this? Because you have given a lot of talk to logic, so What do you think of this?
What do I think about logic in a speech? Is that the...
Yeah, like when you're working on a speech, because there are a lot of speeches given today. I'm not looking at logic from an academic point of view. I think logic is one of those things. I think we all understand when a logic something is logical and something is illogical. But when it comes to public speeches, what do you do with the logic? How do you start with logic first and then say, okay, I think I got my logic right. Now let me work on seeing how I can accentuate that logic through stories, perhaps injecting humor. Because at the end, there is something you're saying, but the people have to believe what you're saying. And they're only going to believe you, or they're going to it's going to be long-lasting, or they're going to take an action if the logic makes sense. So I'm trying to ask you, like, when you work on your speech, how do you deal with logic? Do you put that up front, or do you say, okay, you know, I'm just focusing on my delivery and all that, but logic, you know, it's I'm not really going to give a lot of thought to it. I'm not sure. That's not what you do, but I just wanted to kind of get your viewpoint on that.
Yeah, thanks, Jay, for asking. So I kind of have a two polar opposite background, so I like to bring both into my speeches. So I have spent about 20, 30 years in information systems technology, and logic plays a huge role because in component design, you all the pieces have to fit, right? Otherwise, garbage in, garbage out. Of garbage in, you get constipated, nothing comes out. So that's all bad. there is a place for logic, but I'm also a very intuitive, inspirational kind of persona or personality. So the question I usually work with is about what makes you tick, what makes you... Actually, the Gilbert speech is a great kind of thing which talks about what makes you tick, what is authentic. So I think there is... I think you're right that logic is simple and logic is deep, you know. But when I first start making a speech, I want to get the message. What message I'm trying to get. Out of that, I try to figure out what are the aligned or resonating value systems or background, the prima facie, the foundations that is helps me to make the speech set make sense. So having jumped the gun on logic here, so I wanted to say that logic is really important as a tool, but I also wanted to say that in order for us to grow, we investigate the prima facie of logic, right? The foundational things. The foundational value systems, the core value systems of society. So so to me, logic can be manipulated because of things like what is our foundational beliefs, what is our emotional triggers, and what makes us tick. What made Reagan's speech really great was the fact that he knew what our hot buttons were. He knew what our core values were. And he wanted us to, as you say, great speeches are persuasive. He wanted to persuade us to take this position in the global leadership role. And so this is how I use logic, is first I figure out what I want to say. Then I want to learn to look at it and say, what are the fundamental values that in society that I agree with or I don't? And then I take a position and I move forward. You know, these days we talk about Cartesian logic is the mind, but as a human being, we also have a heart. So I think logic is a place when the heart speaks and the mind listens and organizes the thoughts so other people can understand it. That's what I think. Thank you.
Yeah, no, that's good. That's good. Latesh, what are your views on... when you're working on your speech, how do you deal with logic?
Logic is, I think, one of the three pillars, as you mentioned earlier, like what Aristotle had mentioned about the three main entities that defines the structure for any persuasive talk or any speech. From that angle, logic is very important because that establishes the credibility of how clearly the speaker is able to articulate and whether the main objective or the main topic which he is focusing on, whether it is coming through his talks that he is giving out. So it should be supported with some facts, figures, some kind of supporting evidences, which will help to the audience to identify what the speaker is willing to convey and what exactly is the evidences that he's trying to showcase with it. So logic is very critical, and it's like it helps to define the outcome that the person is probably planning to, but he has set as a benchmark or kind of objective of a particular talk or the speech. The logic defines exactly how that outcome has come out as per what he had promised in the initial aspect, in the initial introduction, flow of thoughts. So it's important that logic is built in a step-by-step manner, and basically any discussion, whether it is a professional topic that is being discussed, or it is something to do with a persuasive talk, anywhere wherein we need to bring forth some key concepts, some key clarity in thought, logic helps to define that. And what Julie just mentioned, that there is always a gap between what is logically correct from our normal thinking pattern and what could be ideally correct, which may define the logic, but it may be the right thing to do at that point of time. So that's a call that the speaker has to take, especially when we are in front of an audience who's, because I've been here, I actually gave a small talk day before yesterday about a specific topic which was more of a technical line. So while discussing about that, I didn't have too much of strength in that area, but I was just going about discussing about that. So there were too many doubts being poked. There were a lot of questions being asked. So at some point of time, we need to defy the logic and put across some thoughts so as to put the particular flow in a different direction. So it's basically up to the speaker how you want to actually define the flow and possibly make the outcome as you desire it to be. So that's from me. Thank you.
Yeah, no, those are excellent points. And the one thing you have to remember is that, and I think there's something you mentioned, that when you are coming up with your logic, it doesn't mean that everybody, you're doing your best to explain the logic. Doesn't mean that the other person or the people that are listening are going to see it that way. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But you need to figure out that there are things in your logic that, logic is not like 100% you're right and 100% you're wrong, right? The other person is wrong. There's a spectrum in there. Everything is, there's like, at some point there's this probability, like, here's the things that I know, but I can't predict the future, but based on this, this is what I think makes sense, and that's part of the logic. Let me just give you a quick example on how logic changes things. This is a little historical, but United States, there were three main speeches, you can say, that were given in the United States that you can tie on how this country has evolved. And I'm sure you can cite that with any countries. There are some speeches that everybody remembers because it kind of redefined the country. And with India, it was probably the speech that Nehru gave during Independence Day. That probably is one of the speeches. I'm sure there were others, but that's the one I can remember. And I don't know after that what other speeches have been given that redefined the country. But let me just give you United States, for example. The first major speech that was given in the United States that everybody in this country, whether when you take history, you remember, is the one by Patrick Henry. This was in 1775, and the speech is commonly known as Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death speech, where in his speech he outlines all the things that the British are doing. And at the end he says that, we at this point, time for talk is over, it's time for action. And he ends his speech in a dramatic way. you know, give me liberty or give me death, right? And in the beginning, people there were not really sure that they wanted to go to war with Britain. They were, like, scared. They said, hey, you know, we can still negotiate. The king will come around. King George III, I think, was. He'll come around. But Patrick Henry knew, enough of this. We've done this many times. At this point, you're going to have to act and go to war. And at the end, at that second Conventional Congress meeting in Virginia, Richmond, Virginia, they decided that it was time to go to war. So that's how United States got started with that speech, okay? Then the next major speech that came in the evolution of this country was the Gettysburg Address by Lincoln. Now, at that speech, this was during Civil War, where Lincoln kind of reframed the whole message at that time. And he kind of framed it because, remember, at that point there was a Declaration of Independence. The logic was that all men are created equal. And what Lincoln framed it is saying that he doesn't focus on who's to blame. This is a bloody war, right? He kind of frames it around that this is an experiment, that America was an experiment, and we are testing that. He doesn't say that, hey, South, you basically caused this, or you did this, or you did that. There's no finger pointing. He's kind of saying that this is part of an experiment, and what this war is all about is a testing of that experiment, whether this experiment can still apply. And then, as he says, that the people who have made sacrifices prove that this experiment can continue, and it's a valid experiment, and our job is to basically make this country stronger and better. And that was the logic, and it worked. So that freed the slaves, so that was, you can call it version 2.0. The next major speech that came was Martin Luther King in 1962, I believe. And look at his logic, and I have to read this because this is just amazing. So Martin Luther King's logic is, if you look at that speech, everybody views that speech, I have a dream speech. But if you ever read the transcript of that speech, you'd be even more impressed. Forget about that dramatic, I have a dream. That's what everybody remembers. But here's his logic, and he's saying the following. You know, that Abraham Lincoln, you know, helped free the slaves, but they're still not free, the African Americans. They're still not free like the others. That they don't get to participate in the great American experiment that guarantees the people the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. And he said, the time has come for African Americans to be free as envisioned by the Declaration, as promised actually by the Declaration of Independence. And so until that happens, they're going to continue with their protest to end injustice and indignities that they suffer every day. And then he says, of course, you know, he has a dream of America where everyone can be free to enjoy the fruits of liberty and are judged based on the content of their character. All logical. And then this is his call to action. He says, America must redefine itself where this is becomes a reality rather than still remaining a dream for many. And as it turned out, in 1964, a civil rights bill was passed, and the African Americans now were not just free, but they are essentially got to be equal, and that's what we have. That created version 3.0, and since then there are other speeches given that gives you to dot releases. So I'm using the little tech speak here, 3.1, 3.2, 3.3, 3.4, like we have the marriage, same-sex marriage, things like that. So there's progress. There's a constant evolution. But all that can only happen if their logic makes sense. And all these speeches, basically, they endure today is because the logic was really sound. So I just wanted to kind of put some example behind that, that logic is not something nebulous. It affects people's lives. And if it's really solid, it can change history. Julie, any closing thoughts?
I think that definitely you need some basis for you need the speech to be based in logic, otherwise people can't follow it. So thank you for this topic.
Matesh, any closing thought?
Same here, Jay. I think that was well said, especially that if it is a well said logic, it can change the course of history. That is really well said. Thanks.
Yeah, and obviously, you know, none of us are going to be Patrick Henry or Abraham Lincoln or even Martin Luther King, but if you're in a project manager, a good logic stands the test of time. So always make sure that people may not like your speech, but it can't be because your logic is flawed. You've got to make sure your logic is right. And then you can work on adding the bells and whistles like, hey, what story will help me accentuate that? Should I use humor to help people see the logic more clearly? That's how you use that technique to make your logic really comprehensible. All right. At this point, we're going to take a quick break and move to our second segment. Okay, welcome to Speech Talk Live, episode number 21. My name is Jay Oza, and we're going to, in this segment, review a speech that was given, it's a TED Talk given by Elizabeth Gilbert, who's an author, famous for her book Eat, Pray, and Love. I always get this mixed up. Is it Eat, Love, and Pray, or Eat, Pray, and Love? So I don't know. Maybe Julie will correct me. Julie, do you want to go first? I always tend to go first in this, and I end up taking too much time. So do you want to kind of set this up, and then we can comment on after you give us a little intro on this speech? Do you want to do that?
Sure, I can do that. So Elizabeth Gilbert burst into our consciousness when she wrote the book Eat, Pray, and Love. And she's actually quite an inspirational speaker. And when she was in Chicago, she actually packed a major theater, maybe like somewhere between 500 to 600 people. She has written a new book, and I have not read it, and she's also in that community of people like Brené Brown. I don't know, I think Jay had given us, shared a speech from her. It's all about how to survive how to be creative, and how to survive failure. So Brené Brown's message is, feel the fear, feel the vulnerability, and leverage that into your creativity. And so Elizabeth Gilbert is similarly, she talked about being a waitress and then she wanted to be an author since her child, and this was her home. Home is where you feel comfortable. And she, for 6 years, she was rejected by every author, every publishing house. So every day she received rejection letters. And so she said she survived that. And then this great success come from Eat, Pray, and Love. And then similarly, she lost her home ground because she was no longer comfortable. And she knew that whatever she does will not have the same phenomenal outcome. But she wanted to write. So the question is, how do you sustain your own creativity? How do you do what you love? How do you come home, whatever that home is? And I, so that's the general overview of the speech. Since I have recommended the speech, I think this is a very short and sweet speech. And basically, I like her introduction. She basically started off with a humorous speech about these two old ladies came up to her, and then they kind of inverted it. They thought that she wrote the movie. She wrote the book from the movie, but actually it was the book that created the movie, right? And so I thought that was a nice way of doing the connecting as a speech. Also, I like it that her premise was very simple, and as Jay says, not only was there logic, but was easy to follow logic. Since we're doing this on logic, her basic speech was, I was a failure, I kept at it, I succeeded greatly, I was afraid of failure, rejection, but I overcame that because I don't care what the consequence is. I don't care about the outcome. I just want to do what I love. So her message is just do what you love and don't worry about the outcome. Don't worry about the failure. So that was a very short and sweet message. I think she did a great job. And I think I think what the message was entertaining, it was simple, and people can relate to it. She's very relatable. So in summary, she said, whether it's great success or great failure will bump you out of your home base. Whether you're greatly successful or greatly fail, you will feel like you're not at home. Find a way to get back home and do what you love. And I love that conclusion. So that's my introduction and my review. Thank you.
Latesh, do you want to give your input?
For me, Elizabeth Gilbert's speech talk was quite good, actually. It was basically like wherein she had reached a particular stage wherein like she's able to really very clearly identify what could be success and what could be failure. So she has already been there, done that. So it doesn't really affect her if somebody is coming in and giving her a critical opinion, or if there is a set expectation wherein like something is probably not matching up to the expectations of what probably the audience or what the readers are looking at. But then she is not bothered by it because she has already reached that particular stage, and she tells that what is quite important is to identify where you're most comfortable with or where. So that's very important, because for her, the home, that she feels that she is comfortable and she feels happy and she goes back and she's connected, is what she is really passionate about, that she thinks from her heart, and she looks at the only piece of activity that when she does, she feels really good. So that's about writing. So back and forth, she goes to that particular exercise, wherein like she's able to really overcome this kind of inevitable failures or expectations that she has, or any kind of anticipations that the outside world might have. So again, she tries to draw an analogy between her situation, wherein she says that a person can go into two different states after a particular activity or exercise. So it could be either very successful or it could be like completely a failure. So in either case, it is how the world perceives at that particular situation of that personality. So if it is failure, as per what the society norm says, failure means that means the person is not really up to the mark. He's not probably doing it as per the expectation that the society has. Success, that means he has achieved what they feel is good. But finally, it's quite relative term. It's not exactly what we should think about what the society thinks when we do something, but it's about how you feel from inside. And even if it is a success or a failure, you keep doing it, you do what you feel passionate about, you keep going back to your home, or that is like for her, it's going back to writing, and then you feel actually not really impacted by all this kind of outside judgment. So it's a good talk, and I think it's quite impactful. And the only way, as she says, is like to embrace this failure and create the love for your specific activity you're involved in. Thank you, Jay.
Okay, thanks, Latesh. Yeah, so thanks, Julie, for this speech. The book that she has written that I actually read is called Big Magic. In fact, I think I recommended that on the cohort. And the thing I like about Elizabeth Gilbert is I have not read that other book. I have it. I haven't read it. Eat, Pray, and Love. But the Big Magic book is excellent. After I read it, I just think after reading that book, I think my writing improved immediately, because the way she writes is so clear. It's like water flowing through something, going through rocks. That's how clear her writing is. It's really beautiful the way she writes. In this particular speech, I agree with it. The message that she's trying to convey is, and there are two schools of thought here, and her argument is that you should have a passion and follow that passion. But you're also getting another school of thought out there where people tell you that don't follow your passion. That's kind of foolish. She's in the camp here, says passion. That's how I've been able to that sustain you. And one of the quotes, I think, Julie, you touched upon it, but let me say it again because it's a really an excellent quote. She said, your home is whatever in this world you love more than you love yourself. And that's a pretty profound quote because at the end, that's what you come back to. And it kind of ties back to what Latesh said in his three-minute speech about uncertainty, right? The one thing that is certain in life, everything is uncertain out there. Future is uncertain. For her, the certainty is going home, and in her case, is going back to writing. And that's a pretty important point that she makes in this speech. As far as I looked at this speech and I compared it with Brené Brown's speech. And I preferred the Brené Brown speech for the reason is this speech is too short. The topic she's talking about requires a little bit more time. This speech is really tight. In fact, if you look at the transcript, the speech comes across better written than when she's giving it because she covers so much in this and it's kind of really fast-paced here. But when you read the transcript, I don't know, when you go to TED Talk, it kind of walks you through when she's speaking and you can read the transcript. I always tend to do that. The transcript reads better than the speech that she gives. And I think the reason for that is that this speech requires more than just 7 minutes. This is a pretty deep message where Brené Brown, if you look at her speech, she kind of looks at both sides, you know, people that are criticizing her, but then how does she overcome it? Of course, her speech was more like 22 or something like that, 22, 25 minutes. I think this speech, even though she covers a lot and it's quite effective, I think it would have been a better speech, in my opinion. How she could have made it better is if she had extended it a little bit more, and this is just my opinion, maybe you guys can tell me whether you agree or not, to let's say 15 minutes and kind of slowed it down a little bit and kind of have a conversation with the audience, and that may not be her style. So again, I don't want to say that that's how she should have done it. I'm just comparing, since we do look at different speeches in this show, and when I look at Brené Brown, her speech was very conversational. You could pretty much kind of follow what she was saying. This speech, when I first viewed it, I didn't follow it, but then when I read it and then viewed it, I was able to follow it. But in a real life, that's not what's going to happen. You've got to basically get it on the first try. And with Brené Brown, I pretty much got her speech on the first take when I watched it. So overall, I think she's got a really great message, and she's a great writer. But in my opinion, I think she needed a little bit more time on this speech, more than 7 minutes. I think she gave the speech in 7 minutes. I think the speech needed to be at least 15 to 18 minutes in order to really get us to follow what she was saying. Julie, do you have any comments on that?
Yeah, I think that's very interesting that you said that because she's a writer before she's a speaker, so maybe that's why. And the other thing is it takes about 20 minutes. Like when we do meditation, the recommendation is that it takes about 20 minutes for the body to connect. And I think you're right that Brené Brown is much more reachable and connectable because she is much more conversational rather than delivering a speech, and she used a lot more personal examples. I agree with you.
Yeah, I think if you read the transcript, you'll find out that this is a really well-written speech. But well-written speeches sometimes don't lend itself to be well-delivered. That's where you can tell that Brené Brown is very comfortable in giving speeches, where Elizabeth Gilbert, you almost feel like she's like you said, she started out really well. So I was like thinking like, wow, this is going to be a great speech. That first thing she did, if she had continued, like, you know, make a point and then give some little anecdote, give some that, then it would have really worked well. And that's what Brené Brown tends to do a lot. And I was expecting more of that. Maybe that opening kind of thought put me in a loop thinking that, hey, the rest of the speech is going to be like that. Because that made a lot of sense that, you know, here she talked, even using the accent of these Italian women. But then the rest of the speech just became very serious, and I didn't get that connection that you get when you and again, the audience was like Brené Brown really got the audience into the speech. I didn't see that Elizabeth Gilbert trying that in her speech. And again, I don't know why that speech was 7 minutes, because typically TED Talks are close to 15 to 18 minutes long. So I don't quite understand that. Latesh, any closing thoughts?
Yeah, for me, it was like I was very happy to see that it was only a 7 minutes long talk. So because I was like really running short of time and I had to rush for the program now. So and I just started about around six. I had an hour's time to actually prepare. So I just saw that the earlier talk was like a long talk, about 1 hour, 16 minutes, and this was like 7 minutes. I said, wow, this is great. So I found it to be, you know, like yeah, Jay, you said it right. Like initially, she started off quite on a humorous note, you know, the way she spoke about those two ladies who came and spoke to her. But then, yeah, slowly it became a kind of, you know, a very straight and serious talk. But then it was fine. It was actually driving home the message. And I really liked the way she spoke about the success and failure aspects and all. But, yeah, it could have been done better. No doubt about it. But, yeah, all in all, it was good. Thanks.
Let me ask you this. Which speech do you think was, again, it's not a fair, but I'm just asking, if you're in the audience, which speech would have worked better for you, the Elizabeth Gilbert speech or Brené Brown? Which one would you like to, if somebody was giving you a speech, what kind of speech would work for you, Brené Brown's speech or Elizabeth Gilbert?
For me, like as long as the topic is getting synced in, as long as I'm able to understand what the discussion is going on, that would be more important for me. But yeah, if somebody is going to really keep me impacted, I mean, who is going to keep me engaged with the conversation, I think that's more important than So yeah, I think that's more important than actually looking at judging the speaker by how they are actually delivering it, because anyway, it is a staged talk. They have got like around hundreds of hours preparing for this particular speech to be given on a wider platform. So it's and every person has a different style of presenting. So it's all about how the audience, how we are able to push ourselves to connect to that particular speaker.
Julie,
thank you.
Oh, I already agreed that I think emotional. I got the idea, but emotionally I wasn't as connected, because it was a little too more dry toward the end, and also because I'm part of the choir, maybe I kind of related to it a little more.
Yeah. So I actually read both books, Brené Brown and Elizabeth Gilbert. When it comes to writing, Elizabeth Gilbert is a great writer, but I wouldn't consider her a great speaker. Whereas Brené Brown is a good writer. I wouldn't call her a great writer, but she's definitely a great speaker. So anyway, at this point, I'm going to take a brief pause, and we'll start our last segment. Okay, welcome to Speech Talk Live, episode number 21. My name is Jay Oza, and we're moving to our last segment, number 3. And in this segment, we're going to look at one of the most popular speech that has been given in the last decade. This was a speech given by a professor at Carnegie Mellon. His name was Randy Pausch. And this was a speech that is commonly given at Carnegie Mellon, called if this was your last lecture, it's called the last lecture. If this was your last lecture, what kind of lessons you want to convey to the students? In his case, it wasn't hypothetical; it was real, because he was contracted with pancreatic cancer, and he had only 6 months to live, and 1 month had already gone by. So. What I sent in that were two speeches. One was a shorter version that he gives on an Oprah show, but the one that everybody talks about is a longer version. So I just sent a shorter one in case some of you did not have the time. But the one that you really want to watch is the long version. because he really gets to really connect with the audience. And these are the audience that he's familiar with, the college students. The Oprah one, he was good, but that's not his audience. I mean, he was still very compelling in that, the shorter version. But you could tell that when he was giving that at Carnegie Mellon, he was much looser. These are his people, you know, these are his peeps, as they say. And this is a very interesting speech. It's something that got me thinking that if tomorrow we have to give a last lecture, what would you say? And it really got me thinking about the past life. And he was a young man. I mean, he's only 40, mid-40s, I believe. And he's done a lot. And he crafts his speech about some of the lessons he learned in life, some of the things that he wanted to do ever since he was little, such as playing professional football, what was the other thing, gravity. There are all kinds of stuff that he had listed in his speech. And there's a lesson that he talks about in each of the things that that he learned from different stages in his life. And the speech, the way he's organized it, that these are the dreams he has, and then also how to make dreams come true for others. So it's not just like, this is my dream, and I'm going to do it, and then, but also part of it is to help other people live their dreams too. And I don't know if you saw the long version, but at the end, this speech he gives, this last lecture, wasn't just for the student body. It was really for his children, as he has three young children. They've probably grown up a lot now. This was a speech that was given more than, I think, close to 10 years ago. And this was his way of leaving this lasting legacy. This is what your father did, and he did it in a formal way. But it left a lasting impression to most of us that when you watch that speech, it kind of makes you think about what your life has been like and what kind of things you want to leave behind for your children or for others. So in a way, Randy Pausch achieves immortality by leaving this last lecture. And I think we should all think about that. And I'll just give you some of the quotes that I just... the first one, I think, is very important. I learned a lot from this speech. And it is long, okay? So I don't want to say that this is not your tight speeches we look at, like 15 minutes. This is a speech where he has a lot of time to go into these things in much more detail. And like one thing he says, that have something to bring to the table that will make you more welcome. I mean, that's a very important quote. Think about that. This is what we do in this show, right? You guys, we all bring something to the table. And the more you bring, the more welcome you become. That, hey, this, like Latesh and Julie, you're bringing something to the table. Julie, you know, you brought that Elizabeth Gilbert speech. You've got to bring something to the table. Latesh brings his insight from his IT experience. So there's something you have to bring to the table. When you do that, that makes you more welcome. That's a very clear message right there. This is another one, and I'll just don't want to take up too much time here, that he learned from football, from one of this is the quote that I saw in it. He also talks about these brick walls, which I'll let one of you talk more about. But this is one of the quotes that I liked a lot. And he says, experience is what you get when you don't get what you wanted. That's a great quote. I never thought of it that way. You know, I tell that to my son, but I never use that type of a quote that, you know, even if you don't succeed, you at least got that experience. It's obvious, but the way he said it really brought it out to me. And the last thing I'll just point out is, and this one, I'm kind of mixing up two things here. This one, he said it in this particular way in the Oprah speech that he gave on Oprah Winfrey Show about apologizing. And it says there are three things you have to do with apology. You know, you're sorry, that's one. If it's true, your fault, my fault. And the third one, he says that most people don't do, which I think is he's absolutely correct on this one. How do I make it right? Important. Don't apologize and say, I'm sorry. That's just not enough. It's just the words, right? And saying it's my fault, unless you can make it right, then the apology is not really that sincere. So this was a really great speech, considering that his attitude about death, which is very important, he doesn't want to be sad about his situation, because he said it is what it is, he's had a good life, so he's kind of looking backward, but also looking towards the future. So he does something really amazing here. He's looking at the past and saying that, I may not be here, but you know, there's a lot that you guys are living for, and here's how you can do it based on what I've learned. I can't, you know, I'm not going to be around, but if you do what I've learned, then you will at least carry out the way I have lived life, and you know, and that's what he's trying to convey in this speech. Julie, do you have any comments on this speech?
Yes, Jay, thank you. Thank you for introducing this speech. It was a very inspiring speech for me. He's obviously a great speaker, so I think one of the things that I really liked was when he, you know, I kind of look at how people introduce themselves, and he basically put a paradox together, kind of just like make our brains go woof. And that is, he says, I'm dying. You know, he shows the picture. And then he says, but I'm stronger than most of you. And he started doing push-ups. And I think that kind of like was a wake-up call. You know, I think this whole speech is a wake-up call. So don't be morose. He chose not to be morose. And he's talking to us about life, about living his childhood, how he lived his childhood dreams. And then actually he shared with us lots of great lessons, right? And also he brought his parents into it. So one of the lessons was humility, right? And he says, here is how my mother introduces me. This is my son, the doctor, but not the kind of doctor that helps people, you know? And another great example that he used was, I think he used humor a lot, because we talk about humor a lot. He says, mother is somebody who loves you unconditionally, even when you pull her hair. And then he shows a picture of him pulling his mother's hair. And then he shows a picture of her laughing. I mean, this was like great connection, right? Laughter, humor. And throughout it, he's telling us all these wonderful lessons, like choose to be Tigger. Do you want to be Eeyore? I have some personal reservations, because sometimes I think if you are Eeyore, you can't deny it, you know, but that's my own personal thing. He gave another great example that people are more important than things, right? He bought a brand new car. He was going to take his nephews out for a ride, and the first thing he did was pour soda over the car. So the children realize that they are more important than the new car. And then the little boy had the flu and threw up in his car, and he wasn't ashamed because of that. I think not only does he tell you to, in order to live your dream, he says just live your dream, right? Just do it. Don't worry about the income. But there were also lessons of persistence, where he actually wanted to do virtual reality and be an Imagineer with Disney, and it took him 6 years to do it. But there was also ingenuity or craftiness, because he wanted to experience zero gravity, right? So in order to do that, he had to finagle his way into that experience, and that's where he talked about bringing something in there. It was really heartwarming and heart-rendering, because at the end he said, I didn't make the speech for the public. I made it for three people. And then I think it was a great conclusive statement that brings all these teachings right into, you know, that's what really matters to him. And to witness that, we learned a lot, and we cared about what he cared about. So it was both a head speech and a heart speech. Thank you.
Yeah, that's excellent, Julie. Latesh?
Thanks, Julie. Those were very nice thoughts. I mean, about this particular video, which Rami Pausch had given. It was pretty. I don't know if you, Jay and Judy, if you had actually seen the long version. Actually, when I opened the link which Jay had shared, so I opened the long version initially. So I actually saw the entire 1.5 hour, 20 minutes of the talk, and then I saw that there's 10 minutes link also, the shorter version. So I saw that also. So what I could see is like a slight change in the way he was, actually his mood had shifted. The longest speech was actually given, I think, when the disease was in the initial stages probably, and the shorter one was given at a later phase. So there was a slight, variance in terms of his mood. It was a bit more I wouldn't say aggressive, but he wants. I think there was a kind of a feeling inside him about, why this has happened or something like that. I could connect that, the kind of.
Let me just comment on that. So let's just sort of clarify. So what happened there was that he had given that original speech that you see in the long version. And then it went viral. And that's why Oprah invited him. So it wasn't like early stage or anything like that. What happened was the speech was viral, and he appeared on Oprah because he has a message. And when Oprah says, come on my show, it's hard for anybody, no matter, even if you're dying, to refuse going on Oprah's show. So that was his opportunity to connect to a much wider audience. That's why when you look at the number of hits, even the long version has close to 17 million views. That's a lot, okay, for a speech that's almost an hour and a half long. So I just wanted to make it clear that that's how this thing, the reason why he was on Oprah was because the word got around that this speech was something remarkable, that nobody's ever done something like that. So anyway, go ahead, sorry.
No problem. Thanks, Jay, for that. I didn't know about it, but still, what I saw is that there was kind of seriousness when he was giving the shorter version, maybe in front of Oprah, and when this particular talk was done. It was slightly more serious, not though he had initially done the same kind of exercises, etc., like push-ups, etc., which he did in the longer version. But the kind of humor that he had in the long version was like pretty much evident, and it was coming out really nice. It was in a way the talk that he was talking, he was giving about his childhood dreams, where he had actually framed certain dreams, certain things that he wanted to do, and how he has achieved them. And he tells that there were brick walls that they are there for a reason. They let us prove how badly we want those things. So that was like really nice, nice way of putting across. The critics, people who probably always keep saying, hey, you can't do that. This is not something that we know. So there are always people who would be putting out the negativities, would be giving out the critical aspects to your dreams. But if you want something really passionately, you will be ultimately able to get through it. Like Jay, you mentioned about bringing the right things to the table. So that's also important, like how you deal with people, how you're able to, when you are really after something, right, you will be able to actually come up with some kind of an excuse or some kind of a method by which you'll be able to overcome that kind of a hardship as well. So you tend to become a bit more creative because that is so much inside you that you need to get it. You need to have that in mind. You have to achieve it, that you will do it. So that way, actually, he says that if you are really good and if you're really passionate you just need to make sure that you keep doing it, and when you're pissed off. And he also tells about various learnings that he had when he was talking to, when he was interacting with teams from multiple areas. So one thing that comes to my mind is like when he said that when somebody told him, when you are pissed off or angry at something, just give some time so that there could be a reason why it is happening. So instead of blowing it up, probably just give it some time, and it will automatically come to a conclusion, or it will come to a logical state later. And then probably when you cool off, probably you'll be able to clearly articulate what could be the reason and how it could have impacted. So another thing, like Judy, you mentioned about what his parents taught him about people versus thing, was really good. How he actually empties the soda can into the backseat of his car. just to show that, you know, it's not a living entity. It doesn't have emotions. It's just something to show off. So that's like a really a good thing. And also how he talks about having fun every day, be enthusiastic. He gives an analogy between a tiger and a ear. So he says that you need to be always be having fun every day, you know, and then always tell truth to people. Apologies if you are wrong, if you have hurt somebody, just be apologetic in your attitude. And always try to mingle with people and try to show the good side. You know, people will automatically show their good side to you as well. And always keep giving gratitude. I think that's most important. And when we are actually having a trouble in our life, when we are facing through hurdles, we normally tend to whine and complain. So he says that that still will not solve the problem. So what we need to do is like just concentrate on your activities, work harder, and then karma, the law of karma will automatically play. So instead of complaining and whining, we should be focusing more on our day-to-day activities and just give more than 100% towards the work that we're doing. So just live life the right way. And if you live life the right way, karma will come to you appropriately, and it will be attracted towards you. And finally, the way he actually, you know, dedicates this particular talk to his three kids, and then they will remember this talk when they grow up and they are watching this show. So that was like really emotionally appealing too. And I found this talk to be one of the best talks that I have seen on this particular platform. And thanks, Jay, for sharing this.
Yeah, thanks, Lathesh. Those were very good points that you just made. The speech was a manifesto for living, essentially, for all of us. He's using himself as an example. I mean, even though this is not a religious speech, but in a way, it was very. I thought it was kind of spiritual in many ways. You know, I'll just say just a few things here. One is that he has this two. Message, right? Like when you're living a life and how to live that life, right? And he's saying that, I wrote this down, quote, never lose the childlike wonder, that's how you have to live life. Okay, so that's good. That's what drives us, right? But then he says that you're going to hit a brick wall, and he keeps on showing brick wall in the longer version. I don't think he does that in the short version. Short version is only 10 minutes, and the long version is close to an hour and a half. And if you haven't seen the long version, that's the one you want to see. And he says that brick walls are there for a reason. They let us prove how badly we want things. I thought that's a great quote right there. And he keeps on showing brick walls. That in life, you want to be childlike, but that doesn't mean that you can have a tantrum when things don't go your way. You want to be childlike in reviewing the world, but then you have to be an adult in knowing that there are going to be setbacks, and how do you deal with that will make a difference in your life. You control that. Other people don't control that. So this is sort of like, what exactly do you control and what you don't control? And I think, Lathesh, you mentioned that thing when, I think at one, I don't know which speech he said that, maybe it was the Oprah speech, don't complain, just work harder. That's a great advice. And it's something that he has done throughout his life. And if you look at it, that quote actually is what he's all about. He's dying. He's not complaining. He's just showing people, look, I'm giving a speech. I'm trying to make a difference till the last breath I take, not to my kids, but to others too. And that's the message itself. For him, giving a message itself is what he's all about, that I'm not complaining, I'm just working harder, that as long as I can, I'm still alive and I can do it, look, I'm strong, why should I just go in and have a pity party? I want to celebrate my life, and that's what this whole speech was all about. It's a celebration of life. Any closing thoughts, Julie and Lathesh, before we close this out?
Great, great speeches today and great discussion. So thank you, everybody.
Yes, yeah, same here, Jay. It was a really nice talk, and I had the opportunity to listen to his longer version as well as the short version. And it was really, it was really good to see someone talk so straight from the heart. Thank you.
Okay, guys, thank you very much for joining. And I'm off to Florida, so I'll get this out.
awesome.
I have to attend. I'm attending a relative's wedding, so I'm going to be gone for the next. I'm not even sure how much internet access I'll have. So if you don't see anything posted or anything, it's because I won't get to it till probably Monday, or we'll see. I don't even know if I'll have access to a computer. So, again, thank you very much for giving up your time and participating on this show. I really appreciate it. Thanks, Julie. Thanks, Litesh. And enjoy your weekend.
Thanks, you.
Jay. Thanks, Julie.
Enjoy
your trip. Thank you. Bye.
Great to see you, everybody. Bye.
Bye. Bye.